Welcome to Orchid Life, people. We are here at Vandaland. Today's episode is all about Van Orchids. I've got the world-class specialist, Antonio Romani. He's gonna go over how to take care of these plants, the parts of these plants, and how to grow beautiful Vandas like you see here, right at your own home. And introduce yourself. Tell everybody what's up.
What's up, everybody out there in Orchid Land? It's the Vanda Man. How are you today? We're glad to be back on an episode of Orchid Life here with my friend Eric Iwalata. You know, there's not many people that actually take the time out of their day to go to professional orchid nurseries to teach you what it is. They may take you into their backyard and show you a couple of their plants, but what you're about to see today, guys, I think you're going to find to be just a little bit different. That's what we're shooting for anyways. Again, I am the Vanda Man. This is my main man, Eric Iwalata. Orchid Life is a channel. TheVandaMan.com is the website where you can purchase all these beautiful plants. Vandamaniacs on Facebook is the group you're going to learn how to grow all these plants.
Yeah. Same principles as Orchid Life. We want to make you happy. We want to make you successful with your growing. And there's no better way to do that than to talk to pros like this guy who has made a living of it over 20 years. So we're going to get right into it. We're going to go over the anatomy of a Vanda. We're going to go over the general care of a Vanda, where they come from, what they like, the most common problems typical beginner growers might have with these plants, and how you can overcome all of that. Tony, I got my first Vanda as a Valentine's Day present for my wife, okay? It was a Robert's Delight Blue. I probably had it for about a year and a half until it just perished miserably. I had a couple others, and you know, what was it that, why did you fall in love with the plant?
Ironically, it's close to the same reason, women. I had bought one for my girlfriend, who's now my wife. We were not together at the time. I thought buying her something unique and personal like that would be something that would get me back in her good graces. And no kidding, I bought it at an orchid show on a Friday. And by a Monday, I decided that Vandas were gonna be my life's work. I literally fell that hard for them. And it's easy to see why, with all the different colors and shapes and fragrance, not just the Vandas, but of orchids in general.
Yeah, you know, were you into orchids before the Vanda?
I didn't know what an orchid was.
So Vanda was your first?
Vanda was my first love, absolutely.
And then, of course, you got into orchids serious, but you still remain like the Vanda was the one.
You know, orchids is a lifelong passion. Turning anything into a business changes the dynamic of what it is that you're doing. That's just how it works. But, you know, the cool thing is now that I have not just one of everything I like, but hundreds of everything that I like.
You've gone beyond growing Vandas. Now you're you know, vending them to the world, places like Smithsonian. Disney World,
many theme parks, many of the best botanical gardens in the country feature these plants right here.
Right.
And there's good reason for it. I mean, these are the best that you're going to get. There's no doubt about it. I mean, I haven't so much focused my life on the breeding and the
hybridization.
Yes, and awards like and things like that. To me, that really doesn't do it for me. What I like to do is I like to walk into my own little private paradise and see a piece of exactly what it is that I am, and that is Vanda. I am Vanda. I am the Vanda Man. This is what it is that I do day in and day out. And honestly, having have done it for 22 years, now it's time for me to teach the people that want to learn about them. Not only am I going to grow them and sell them to you, but I'm also going to teach you how to grow them. And I think that's something that's sorely lacking in today's orchid world. There's so many people out there, you know, be it on eBay, you know, Etsy, these places that these people just don't know what they're doing. They don't know what they're growing. They don't know how to grow it. They're going to sell it off to you because you might be a new person and say, oh, this is an inexpensive Vanda.
Yeah.
That's not what it's all about. Listen, Vandas are not cheap. Nothing good is cheap. Remember that. That goes for many, many things in life, and no other thing is it more serious than in growing orchids.
Yeah.
You know, you want to have a plant that's got all of its leaves and all of its roots when you buy it. I see this constantly on the sites that I run. I've got three different Facebook pages that I am the admins of. These are the groups that I teach people not just to grow Vandas, but to grow general orchids in general. I've got groups for professionals and advanced hobbyists, all the way down to the very beginners, because realistically, it starts with the beginning. You're not going to learn how to grow a Vanda in 6 weeks. That's just not how it works. You get on a lot of these pages out there, folks, and all you're going to see is 50 different opinions on how to actually grow them. That's not how it works.
Yeah. You can see it on YouTube. Go to the other YouTube channel.
Yeah, for real.
Check it out. You'll see these people promoting Vanda care and Vanda orchids. You look at their Vandas and half the leaves are missing. It looks like palm trees. You'll see nothing but stalks. That's not how it is. You know, this is a plant that hasn't been stressed out. This is a plant that's been growing prolifically and has had no stress.
That's right.
quality green color, roots and everything else.
When you buy, that's what you want to buy. Yeah, you don't want to buy somebody else's
You
cults.
Get some of this stuff from Home Depot, Lowe's, from all these places, and they've been stressed out. You are buying a plant that is doomed for failure. The plant fails, and then you're like, you know what? I just can't grow these things. You're discouraged, and again,
being discouraged is probably the worst thing that you can ever be. And that's one of the things I try to tell people. Listen, this plant, you did not kill it. This plant was already dying when you bought it. Where you failed was that you didn't buy from a reputable grower, from somebody that knows what they're talking about and knows what they're growing when it comes to growing Vandas. Vandas are not Phalaenopsis. Vandas are not Dendrobiums. They're not Cattleyas. They're Vandas. They're very specialized plants that in 25 years ago when I started, this was the absolute top of the heap as far as orchids is concerned. And, you know, due to advancements in technology and things being more readily available to people, they've become a little bit less expensive and a little bit more accessible to the general public. But that doesn't mean that it's going to be a good, healthy plant. You want a healthy plant. What Eric pointed out is exactly what you want to see. This plant has all of its leaves. Look at the root system on this plant. This is not a root system that is in peril. All right. If you buy a plant that's missing half of its leaves, and I have some nice examples around here somewhere. Let me see if I can find where I stuck them. Thank you, Eric.
Yeah.
This is a plant that I bought from an online retailer. Okay, I paid good money for it. I paid more than I normally pay for it because I wanted to buy something to show people exactly what the difference is. They're proud of this plant. Look at this thing's not even in its basket. You see that? Everybody says, oh, cut the basket off. You don't have to cut the basket off of this one. This one's falling out of its basket.
Yeah.
The wire is all hanging silly sideways. Ironically, it's from the same supplier that I use in Thailand, so there's really no excuse why the plant would look like that. But look at that. You see, I'm missing half of my leaves. I've got good, hardcore fungal infestation going on here. This plant is suffering from numerous ailments. It actually has a lot better roots than most of the plants that you're going to see out there for other people. I mean, I ain't going to lie to you. This is a big old fat root. That's because I've had it for a couple of months. But I just wanted to show you. That's what you're going to get versus a healthy, well-grown Vanda.
Yeah. Okay? This is probably the worst Vanda he can find in yeah. this place because
I have to buy it from somebody else.
Yes, yes, yes. And so that's the example of the bad. But we do want you to know, you know, quality plant versus a plant that has a poor foundation that's going to give you problems.
You're not going to be paying much more for that plant than you are for this plant.
So
you get what you pay for.
Let's get into, you know, again, this is going to be a good general overview.
Watch what we do to plants like that. You ready?
Oh, there it goes.
Look, it don't want to leave.
Up on the root. So
let's try that again. All right. Take
one,
two. Ready?
Two.
Watch this. That's what we do with those plants.
Yeah, you got to get rid of them. You don't want them dripping and infecting your other plants, especially if they've got some of the infections. But let's go right into the parts of this plant, what its characteristics are, and how to, you know, you'll be able to read what the plant's doing, if it's happy, if it's unhappy, through the characteristics.
I got to be honest with you, Eric. This shit is a little boring for me, but I will show you just so that we can say that we've gone through this at least once, the parts of this plant, okay?
Yeah.
Obviously, these are the flowers, okay? The flowers have individual parts themselves. The two on this side here, these are petals, okay? There's two petals per flower. The upper dorsal sepal, the lower sepals on the plant, that makes up the whole entire flower. Two petals, three sepals, okay? This is the reproductive part of the plant. This is where all the magic happens. In nature, if this thing was going to be pollinated, this is exactly where it would happen. Down inside of there, and I'll do my best to kind of pop that off and see if I can show it to you.
We can do a better close-up so you don't have to worry too hard. But yeah, underneath
this. See how I just popped that out?
Yeah.
Right there's the pollen. That's what's doing the magic right there. That's what's going to actually pollinate that particular flower. It's very possible that in nature that plant right there, this right here, would go right up underneath here and pollinate that flower. It would shoot right up underneath there, get stuck. What would happen is this flower would fade, but this part of the flower right here, that's called the pedicel, I'm sure you can all see that. In Vandas, it's got that nice little whorl to it. Okay, it's twisted because the flower actually opens upside down. This would swell up. And inside there would be seeds. That would be the seed of the orchid. That every one of those things would be different. That's the neat thing that you'd understand when you're understanding and working with orchids. These things would hybridize with themselves. If you want to have something that's exactly the same, you want to have 1,000 of the same exact plant, you have to get a clone. And that's a totally different manner of growing than a hybrid is. A seedling, everything's going to be different. Every plant's going to be different. It has the same parents, just like you and your brothers and your sisters, but every flower looks different. Everyone acts different. Some of them perform better than others do. Some of them don't do anything. Some of them turn out to be highly awarded orchids. That's the hybriders craze. That's really not what I'm into. I mean, it's cool. I understand it. creating an orchid for me is not where it is. Where it is for me is to grow this particular orchid as well as I possibly can. And as you can see just from the pictures around here, I'm not playing around. These are well-grown orchids. These are floriferous orchids. They're flowers that have got good saturation, good color, good size, good flower count. That's what you're looking for in Vandas in particular. So that's the flowers. That's the business end of the plant. This plant doesn't care whether or not it has this, whether or not it has this. What this flower plant cares about is whether it has this, because that's how that thing is reproducing itself. All right? Moving on from our flower, we have the main body of the plant, okay? You have your stem, obviously. You have your leaves, okay? Now, the stem is what transports the nutrients from the root system up to the top of the plant. Right there where I'm pointing, that's what they call the apical meristem. That's where that plant is actually growing from. When they go to clone these plants, what they do is they pull that top out, and down inside there's what they call undifferentiated cell tissue. That cell tissue they can take to a laboratory, they can do their little scientific magical mumbo jumbo and create 10 billion of that same plant if that's what they want to do. That's where it happens, right down here. We'll call that the heart of the plant, but it's actually called the apical meristem of the plant, okay? The leaves are storage organs of nutrients and water for the plant. It's pretty obvious that this plant here doesn't have soil. There's no way for this plant to store nutrients in water other than in its leaves and in its roots. And we're gonna get to the roots in just a minute. Your leaves are very important, okay? If you have plants that are missing a lot of leaves, that's indicative of a lot of stress over the life of that plant. If you have plants that are ate up with spots on it, that's indicative of problems. I will say this, if you can manage to keep your leaves and have spots, you're doing better than the people that lose their leaves. All right, in the grand scheme of things, you're doing better than the people that are losing their leaves. But ideally, this is what you would see, is uninterrupted growth of a monopodial orchid. Okay, a monopod orchid is a type of an orchid that grows from a central stem. All right, now when this plant reaches a certain amount of maturity, a certain level of maturity, it's going to put out babies, and everybody calls them keikis. That's the name of them. A lot of people call it keikis, but it's tomato, tomato. Keiki is how they say in Hawaii. All right, this plant, you see, this is one that we were going to talk about because it's not as healthy as it seems, but you can see even this dog has a couple of keikis hanging off of it. It's got some babies. All right, moving on to the roots, what you want to see with Vandas is a developed and advanced root system. If you do not have a developed and advanced root system, you're not going to have a healthy plant. And what I mean by developed and advanced is like this, where you've got many filaments of roots that are coming down. The roots themselves are actually pretty tiny. What you're seeing on the outside here is velamen. Okay, this is a spongy layer that Vandaceous orchids and mini orchids have evolved to grow on their roots so that they can maintain a certain moisture balance. If this plant was growing in its native habitat, which for these particular plants is Southeast Asia, India, down into the Philippines, things like that, they would be constantly bathed in high humidity air. It's raining every day. The days are always 12 hours day length. The sun is always bright. That is where this plant comes from. We can attempt to mimic that here in the United States. The farther south you are, i.e. the Keys, Homestead, Miami, then you're gonna have a good shot at it. The more farther north you get, you start getting into the Carolinas, you know, New York, out west, the weather is totally different. So you're gonna have to work a little bit harder. And we are gonna make a video about growing plants, these plants successfully indoors, but we're gonna do that at a later time. Right now, we're gonna talk about if you live in a nice hot part of the country where it's always humid, i.e. like Florida, Southern California, things like that, all right? You wanna see good, healthy roots. On your roots, you wanna see these nice little appendages that are popping off. I don't know how well you can see it on the camera, but those are active root tips. That's the active growing part of the root system of the plant. That's what you wanna see. During the winter months, these root tips go away. They stop growing, they kinda go dormant. This time right now, we're in the second day of June. These plants should be actively popping out roots everywhere, making nice big fat basal roots here. That's what you wanna see too. Nice roots, big tips, okay? This is the time of the year in the summer that you wanna see that. Again, in the wintertime, as the sunlight goes away, the farther north you get, the more the problem's gonna be exacerbated, the more those roots are gonna retreat, okay? This is a healthy Vanda. Okay, this is what you want to see. It's not the most beautiful Vanda flower because that's not what we're talking about right now. What we're talking about is overall good quality health, presented itself well, flowers held above the foliage, nice and flat round flower. That's a true Vanda. That's what you want to see when you're growing Vanda orchids, okay?
Real quick, I've just known this from being around you, but I've seen a lot of people actually complain when they see the root tips like this.
That's a fantastic point to point out there, Eric.
So you'll notice these root tips.
Those aren't roots, those are leaves.
Right? I'm sorry. You know, I get caught up. Sorry. These leaf tips, I'm sorry. Forgive me. But yeah, these leaf tips are very, you know, that's a...
A lot of you will notice these things look like something's been chewing on them, all right? Vandaceous orchids as a family are very easily identified by what they call praemorse leaf tips. And what praemorse is Greek for having the appearance of having been chewed on, okay? These leaves look like they've been chewed on. They haven't. That's just a part of a vanda. You'll notice the newest leaf that comes out here of the top of the plant, the newest leaf has it too. If there's an insect that can evenly chew off all those leaves, we're in deep trouble. That's just a part of the vanda. As you get farther into, you notice some of them have it more than others. This plant has less of a pronounced appearance of that.
Gotcha.
We get into certain different types of vandaceous plants. The leaves might be blunt, but they'll always be split at the end like that. There's nothing wrong with that on a plant. That's what you want to see. That's called a praemorse leaf tip on a vanda.
You know,
there's only actually two different types of growth in orchids, Eric. You've got monopodial, which is a vanda, right? Grown from a single stem. They can't make babies that will come off, but every plant is originating from a single stem. Or you have what they call sympodial growers, like cattleyas, dendrobiums, basically anything that puts off a new growth. Like you can see here, we got some nice fat new growths coming off. This is a sympodial orchid. You notice these bulbs are nice and fat. Those bulbs are storing water and nutrients right now for the benefit of the new growth. These growths don't care. These have already done their thing. They're basically, their purpose in life right now is to support their babies, which is what these are right here. This is a sympodial growing orchid.
Is the crown right here your basic tell for the vanda is if it's doing the
this
proper
is where, growth? This is where the most obvious part of it is growing. You can see we got a new leaf that's just starting to pop out right there. You can see how it's still nice and white because it hasn't been exposed to the sun long enough to make chlorophyll. That's going to be more advanced type of growing type of thing, but you can kind of tell how fast your plants are growing by. You see this white line that's right here? Not even a line. It's more like a white area on the plant. The more that white there is, the faster that plant is growing because that means the leaf is coming out faster than it can actually produce chlorophyll. And that's an important marker for how fast these plants are growing.
Gotcha.
One of the things that's important to understand in here, this is production style growing, all right, guys? I'm not out here spraying hormones. I'm not putting seaweed on my plants. I'm putting good light, good water, good fertilizer on the plants, and I'm making them grow like they're supposed to.
All right, so making them grow, let's teach the people at home how to make your vandas grow like they're supposed to.